Okay, hey guys. So we're going to get started. A little bit of heads up. So we had some technical difficulty with the original presentation, the value-driven vertical slicing. This is still an Agile talk, but it's around transformation to Agile. So whereas the last one was more about how to do global management in Agile. So I won't be offended if anyone wants to get up and head out. but it looks like we're okay. Wait. So today we're going to be talking about a digital transformation of Agile. In particular, we're going to be talking about the story that open software went through when we did do a big transformation about a year and a half, 2 years ago, when we went from our old project management methodology and completely shifted the company to an Agile Scrum methodology. It was truly a full company-wide change. It wasn't something that happened overnight. It's actually, I'd say we're about a year and a half to almost 2 years in, and we're still working on improving it. Today's talk is really structured in a way that, first we're going to take a real quick look at project management from a 10,000 foot view, and then from there we're going to dive into, what were the challenges we were having using traditional project management, and then after that, the challenges specifically, and then Steve's going to talk about how we overcame those challenges, so we're going to do a little dynamic back and forth. So quick introductions though before we get started. So my name is Chris Smith, I'm the founder of Open Software. We're headquartered here in Ottawa. We have 32 employees today and we're growing really, really quickly. My background, so I studied business, commerce at the University of Ottawa, did some system design at Carleton at grad school. After that, I started teaching at Algonquin. A lot of our kind of designers and developers that are over today were actually my Drupal students way back in the day. And then after kind of a good lengthy career as a consultant, a lot of government work in Ottawa, I transitioned, I started to open. Since then, I've been learning about this world of agencies and Drupal's been all of it. And I've been really, really fully kind of devoted to this for the last 5.5 years.
Yeah. So my name is Steve Lavigne. I've been a developer for about 12 years. I work at Open with Chris. Been there for about four. Started at Open as a developer, transitioned into more of a tech lead architect role, and then since transitioned into a product owner from the Agile perspective, which we'll get into shortly. Throughout that process, I also became a certified Scrum Master and certified product owner as well.
Yeah, I forgot to mention, I followed with Steve through that certification process, so I'm also Scrum Master, Product Owner, and PMI certified assistant project management. So we've definitely done our training and our studies. So first of all, to know, who are you guys? So out of curiosity, how many of you are from are working in teams today, let's say 0 to 10 people, 1 to 10? Perfect. Anyone in that like 10 to 20 range? Anyone in like a 20 plus range, bigger size teams. And are any of you project managers today? Cool. Product owners? Scrum Masters? Okay, great. And out of curiosity, if you were to say the methodology that we follow at our team or within our team, Agile, strict Agile? Kind of Agile? Yeah. Waterfall?
Or water slump, or anything of the above.
All those fun fixes. Okay, that's good. That gives us a really good pulse on who we've got to work today. So, let's jump into a little bit of history of project management. I always say before we talk about where we're going, we've got to understand where we've been. So, this part, bear with me for the next couple of minutes. This might be the most boring part of today's talk. I want to take a big step back. We've actually flip the slide there, Steve. So project management is celebrating its 100th anniversary this year. So in 1917, project management first came to be. So I want to ask you guys, what was going on in the world in 1917 that might have made project management an important skill set back then? World War I was happening. So in 1917, if you can imagine a time before that, they were just doing kind of off the wind. And then all of a sudden came this massive war, and we had to figure out, well, how are we going to get resources to the troops? So people started saying, well, we've got a lot of food in the warehouse, and we've got these trucks over here, and we've got troops out in the field, so let's bring all of the food, big step, let's get into the trucks, and from the trucks, let's bring it to the field, and then from the field, let's do a big distribution. And then they put together this formal kind of way of managing that, they called it the Gantt chart, and then eventually the waterfall model. 1917 waterfall project management was And today, we still see waterfall being one of the most commonly used project management methodologies in software development, 100 years later. So I think that a lot of people don't really recognize how long and how far back waterfall goes and where it started. But waterfall is all about stages. We have a project, and we go from one stage to the next stage to the next stage. And then from there, over the next 100 years, it really started to evolve. We had a methodology called critical path. Critical path was invented almost 40 years later, and it said that in project management, the way that we're going to be able to predict the end of a product or a project is by looking at all the steps that are critical that need to be accomplished. If we have a good sense of what's critical and we kind of block out everything else on the peripheral, well then from there, we can then determine what it's going to take to get from one step to another. In around 1950s, there was an IPMA, was released in Vienna, in Europe. It was the first accreditation in project management. And of course, Europeans are always there 10 years ahead of us. So, they did that in the 50s and the 60s. We came out with PMI, so the Project Management Institute released their own accreditation in North America. And at that time, then project management became a career. You could become a professional project manager. Since then, we've had other methodologies and approaches that have been developed. We have one that was developed that said, we're going to start taking a list of all the tasks that we need to do in a project. We're going to come up with a whole bunch of different estimates. We're going to add all those estimates together and it's going to tell us how long the project takes. So really kind of like the birth of estimation. Computers came around in the 60s and 70s, and all of a sudden we had this thing called Prompt 2. I'm talking about words there. Prompt 2. Prompt 2 was this project management methodology that was created that all of a sudden we were trying to recognize, well, computers are different. So computer programming and software development is fundamentally different than, say, managing how do we get food to the troops in the war. So we needed a different way of dealing with it. Well, Prompt 2 tanked, completely failed, no one picked it up. But then 10 years later, it comes back as Prompt 2, and then eventually rebranded as Prince. And then Prince explodes in Europe, and then all of a sudden every European agency and firm and big SI is using Prince 2 to manage all the projects. So then Prince 2 is born. Around 1989, Scrum, the first time Scrum is used. And all Scrum meant back then was that we're going to make small teams of people and they're going to work on things together. So let's take away this idea of these massive teams, let's make really small teams, and let's develop software iterations. And then it wasn't actually until 2001 that the Agile Manifesto was written. And I'll talk about that in a minute, but Agile then was born in 2001. They took concepts from the critical path theorem, they took concepts from the estimation that we talked about, they took concepts from all the way back to waterfall. And then they said, but things are broken and not working in modern day, so we need to come up with a new set of values and a new set of principles. And that's where transformation to Agile really began. The transformation to Agile itself, if you've done any kind of background or research on it, it has four key values. One of those values is in the collaboration between the people. So they're saying that instead of working within silos, your teams must be working collaboratively, and we must be having an open discussion all the time. There's also a lot more focus on actually delivering working products than there is on documentation. So a lot of old project management methodologies, even waterfall, it was all about giving my Gantt chart, and then when things change 2 days later, give me another Gantt chart, and then another Gantt chart, and you're stuck in this cycle of updating documentation. Agile, one of their core values, said we need to get rid of all this documentation. It makes no sense. Projects change too often, so let's focus on delivering real-world products instead. And then they had all these other principles, 12 other principles. I encourage you guys, before you jump into Agile, to read them. Because if you read them and you understand them the way that they're written, you're going to see that, wow, they're really asking a lot. And that's why we're doing this presentation, because there were a lot of challenges. One of them was that there's no more specialists. And we're going to talk about cross-functional teams in a bit, but if you fancy yourself as a senior developer or a front-end specialist or a back-end migration guy, well, all of that idea goes out the window, because all of a sudden the idea in Agile is we're generalist cross-functional teams. And that's part of their 12 principles. There's also principles on simplicity. There's principles on collaboration, constant feedback loops so that we're constantly improving and keeping an open mind and learning. But all these principles and these values, what ended up happening was it defined a new way of managing projects. And that new way that got taken even further into what we call methodologies. So we have the Scrum methodology, we have one called Kanban, we have extreme programming, we've got all these different applications. Today we're going to be talking about our transformation to Scrum. That was my 5-minute history lesson. Okay, let's talk a little bit about Scrum here. So Scrum is our flavor of Agile, but we decided to move towards that open. To give you a little history on where we started before we transitioned to Agile. So our agency, I'd say 2-3 years ago, we didn't have a project manager at all. We were 8 rows, all dudes, sitting in an office, less than 1,000 square feet. Half of the guys were my fraternity, so that gives you a sense of the maturity of the class or the class of the room. And then I remember when we began interviewing our first project manager, because I had a lineup of people waiting at my office to be on the couch when I was eating my lunch. And there were these guys, my coworkers were sitting there and said, Chris, this manager that you're bringing in, is he going to start working? Yes, it does. It means work is going to feel a little bit more organized, probably. So don't worry, it's a good thing. And they were really, really concerned that, you know, the introduction of a project manager into COVID was going to make things dramatically different. And trust me, we still do have a lot of fun. One of the benefits that we got right away, though, is that in talking to our clients, we said, well, there's actually a big difference in the open that you've been working with and the version now. We said, you know those broad requirements that you were throwing at us? Well, now we have someone there to digest them. You know those deadlines that we kept blowing? Well, now there's someone full-time dedicated to your project, making sure we never go over time or over budget again. And it actually gave us a competitive edge. And Steve put it really well when we were prepping for this earlier. He basically said it was actually a stepping stone in our company when we brought in our first PM. We started with our waterfall methodology. And we took this big step forward. It helped us grow as a company, and then we became a team of 15, 16 people, where we only were 8 guys disorganized. So we brought in waterfall, we brought in project management, but within that a year and a half ago, I should say, we started hitting bigger issues. So the waterfall methodology is really front-loaded and it's stage-based. So one thing that waterfall does to you is it says, well, we're going to do all this discovery up front, we're going to figure out everything you need, we're going to map it, and then we're going to put a huge Gantt chart together, and we're going to tell you exactly how your project is going to flow. And then, needless to say, because I'm sure all of you have felt it before, is that you get to about the end of 2 weeks and then everything is shifted. And either your documentation hell or you're redoing your documentation over and over again, and you're trying to predict where this waterfall is going to end up. But more often in our case, what happened is that we then started with discovery, we moved into requirement design, we got down into like visual design, we built our content types, our vocabularies, our views. Oh, we ran out of time, we're money, and now we have no time to deploy or do your thing. Okay. Right? And then the product itself I brought to deliver because of that sequential approach. So a year and a half ago, I was sick of this, Steve was particularly sick of this. So we threw up our hands and we said we need something completely new, we're transforming the company, we're going to this new modern approach called Scrum, we're going to ditch the 1917 methodology waterfall. And we started that process to mitigate against those big issues that we were having as an organization. So that's Scrum. So let's talk about the challenges. We're going to let Steve talk a little bit too. But one of the first challenges that we had when we went from waterfall to Scrum was in the commitment itself. So one thing that you have to notice is that this is a big change. This isn't a little change. So when it comes to commitment, you need senior executive commitment. And that's not just me, the founder, but also I have the CFO, we have executives, we have managers. All of the senior staff in our company had to be committed to Agile because one, this was going to change their jobs. Their job roles were really going to change when they did every day had to change. They had to be invested and they had to lead the team. And then the developers, they also had a huge challenge as well. So the developers are used to working in silos. We had front-end specialists, we had back-end specialists, we had the migration guy with a big beard, right? Like we had all those folks. And we had to tell those developers, you know what, you're comfortable with migration API, but tomorrow you're writing SAS code. And you who's never done anything except a grids and SAS and JavaScript, well, you know what, I'm going to need you to write the first custom module because we're becoming a cross-functional team. There were a lot of challenges as we needed the commitment from the developers to accept that their jobs were going to change as well. So Steve, how do we overcome?
Yeah, so like Chris was saying, we talked a little bit at the manager level. We needed to make a change, we needed to move on from 1917. So it really started from the top down. So we started with the management team, getting an Agile coach, taking some courses, reading as much material as we can, meeting a lot, meeting again, meeting yet again, to really understand from all parties what we were getting ourselves into, making sure we were doing it for the right reasons. Once we were comfortable from a management level, we essentially brought it down to the developers, made sure that they had a say, what did it mean to go agile or fully agile, how did it change their job role. Like Chris said, the migration guy who just wanted to lock himself in a room and look at the terminal all day couldn't necessarily just do that anymore. They had to do a little bit more, be a little bit more generalists. So we made sure that we brought whatever we learned from the courses and the material that we learned, brought that down to the development team, made sure that they were aware. One of the points, and Chris touched on it as well, is it took money. So we had to work with our CFO to come up with the money to pay for training, to allow our developers to go and take courses, come to conferences like that, like this one, sorry, things like that. So we had to talk to her, and through that process, we ended up finding grants and things that we can actually use to bring that cost way down to allow us to actually afford to do this stuff. And then transparency is a big thing. So we wanted to make sure that we were transparent from the top to each other, but we were also transparent to everyone else in the company, and vice versa, where we wanted that transparency from the developers to also come up and talk to the managers as we were making this transformation and really decide how we were going to go about doing it. So essentially just nipping questions in the bud, making sure that transparency is there, making sure that if there was a single question, we kind of talked about it right away. We came up with processes. We didn't want this. We knew that the Agile transformation was going to take some time, but we didn't want to take too much time to even answer a question or come up with a solution to a problem.
So the next challenge, and this is going to be the flow for now. The next challenge was the cross-functionality. So I mentioned that our teams, in the way that Agile set up its principles, is that everyone is meant to work in a cross-functional capacity. So that doesn't mean that you're now the migration guy, like we're talking about, but instead every day you're a coder, you're a tester, you're a back-end, a front-end person, you're also a business analyst, and perhaps one day you're doing some discovery sessions as well. So cross-functionality presents a lot of challenges. One of them is knowledge. A lot of people have developed their experience in one particular area or another. So when you end up hiring candidates for the company, you usually end up saying, or that person will say, well, I'm a front-end guy. It's like, what am I? And how comfortable are you writing your PhD code and object-oriented programming and so on? So cross-functionality for us had a huge challenge because our teams could no longer be specialists, and we had to encourage people and get them outside of their comfort zone so that they would begin to become more cross-functional.
Yeah, and the way we did that was we knew that the back-end guy still wanted to be the back-end guy, or at least still wanted to make that part of their skill set. So we had to do something where we had primary skills and secondary skills, kind of is how we developed it internally, where primary skills is more that generalist. So we made sure that everyone had a baseline of that primary skill. So if there was a task at the top of the sprint backlog that someone had to use, anyone can essentially take that on and take on that task and at least have that baseline of knowledge to know that they can achieve that. But however, just to make sure that everyone was still happy, everyone still was able to do what they wanted to do, a back-end person can still be a back-end person, and a front-end could be a front-end. We had secondary skills. So as much as the primary was that generalist, the secondary, we still allow people to go and learn Solar, or go learn as much as they can about Angular, or as much as they want about migrations, things like that. In order to do that, we invested a lot of time and money into training for our staff, both to make sure that everyone had the same baseline. So everyone essentially got Acquia certified in the company. Everyone had the same baseline, which made us understand, just as a whole team, that whoever took that next card or that next task knew what they were doing to get it done, at least to some capacity. And then we also kept on investing in training for those secondary skills. So making sure that people can still take secondary courses to essentially expand their knowledge. And then with that, for the knowledge transfer piece, we can't do it all with training. Essentially, it just came down to pair program. So we made sure that if we had a migration script to do, the person that has done 10 migration scripts also sat with the person who did 0 migration scripts. and make sure that they did it together and transfer that knowledge. Yes, it costs a little bit more for us, it takes a little bit longer, but hopefully the next migration that comes in doesn't necessarily have to be pair programming. That person that just learned it can take it on and maybe transfer that knowledge to someone else, and so on and so on.
The next challenge here is the business know-how. So as you start to transform into Agile, you start to realize that Agile is really the delivering business objectives. When I meet with clients, they say, Chris, today we're a $25 million organization, and in 5 years we want to be $100 million. Can you tell me how Drupal's going to do that for me? Extremely broad business objectives that need to be overcome, and we're responsible for coming up with the technology that's going to do that. So the business know-how comes into play because that conversation doesn't just happen with me anymore, and it doesn't happen with our sales and marketing team, but it also happens with the developers. So the product owner, for example, needs to be able to sit in the room and understand the mission of the project, and he needs to be able to speak to the business or the client. But so do the developers when they're saying, I recommend we take this approach rather than this approach. It's not just because I believe that this is a better technical solution, but this is why or how it's going to meet your business objective in a better way. So for us, we have to figure out, well, how is it that we're going to bring a business knowledge from all these different verticals and industries to our development team, to our management team, that haven't necessarily had a chance to develop community experience in those areas? So
yeah, so it started with the product owner, which in this case is my role now at Open. So product owner came about as half a tech lead and half a business analyst. To make sure that, in most cases as a tech lead, I was still in those meetings, I was still collecting requirements, but I was collecting those requirements strictly based on just Drupal, or based on building a custom module. That has since evolved into, yes, I still need to know how Drupal works, or how the technology that I use every day works, but put a little bit more of a business hat on for a business analyst, and ask different types of questions. So what's your actual vision? What's your end goal? You're paying less to come up with a solution. So let's not talk about the solution now. Let's talk about just what you need. Like Chris said, we're going to pay you money to transform our company. We need to transform this website. We need this as a complete end goal. So we started bringing that kind of mentality into meetings. And then the second thing we also did is it wasn't just me anymore that was in those meetings. It was the entire team. So we all had different hats on. Me still as the product owner. Me still has a technical background. But we also had the developers in the room. Since they're all generalists, it was made up of people that would typically do design or back end or front end, and make sure that they were in the room as well. So it wasn't always coming from a client to a PM to a tech lead to a development team. It was really just everyone was in those meetings moving forward, which allowed us just to make sure that we had that business know-how. So they knew, everyone on the team knew what that vision was, what the client actually wanted, what are we working towards when we go back to our desk, put our headphones on, and start programming.
The next challenge is on learning. So you guys have no doubt picked up already that this process requires a lot of learning. The developers that were focused on one particular task now had to learn and become generalists and all of the others. There were certifications for us as managers to get our Scrum Master and our product owner certifications, but also developers that have become certified in other technologies or areas that they weren't particularly great at. So there was an amount of learning that had to be done, but also there's a continuous amount of learning that needs to, or sorry, there's a bunch of learning that needs to happen continually. So for us to be able to make the best recommendation to our clients in terms of this technology can meet your business objective, we need to stay ahead of the innovation curve. We need to be constantly reaching out into our research, figuring out, well, what is the next great thing, what are the options that are available to us. So all of a sudden, moving to Agile meant that we couldn't get stuck in our ways, we couldn't become specialists and adapt on very niche things. We had to really broaden our vision and what we were learning, or the breadth of what we were learning, sort of. And we had to devote a lot more professional development ourselves, as well as the teams, to make this happen. There were a few things we did to overcome them.
Yeah, so we started by just, like Chris said, sure you guys are hearing that a lot of learning is involved. And what we did is every new employee that came on board, it didn't matter what their skill set was or whether they were a junior or a senior, we still gave them two or three sprints to learn and fail and try something a little bit differently and find a place in the team and learn how to jive with the team, grow with the team, understand what we were trying to accomplish. So obviously a big investment from the company, from Chris, to allow people to do that. And then as we go through and evolve and say that one person has now been with us for months, everyone on the team still has allotted learning time. So every sprint we try to still have a little bit of that learning time, where it's not as much as it was maybe at the beginning, but in every sprint we still have a little bit of time for us to learn and make sure that we have that knowledge. And then it comes to retrospectives. So for those who know the Agile framework, at least know what a retrospective is, at the end of every sprint we have a retro, which is essentially the sprint team comes together in a room and talks about how the sprint went. We learn from each other, not necessarily in that case from a technical perspective, but more from just team management, processes, things like that.
The next role change. So it's not every day you come to work and your boss tells you that the job is going to be completely different than the job description that you signed out day one. So Agile for us, actually from an HR perspective, it was a role change for quite a few people. If you were on the operational side of our company, so the development side, if you were a tech lead, you became a product owner. You were used to talking about, like Steve said, requirements in terms of how is this done in Drupal, and now you have to go and lead discovery sessions and vision settings meetings. You had to be comfortable with that change. The developers as well, there was a big change in their job because all of a sudden, one, you weren't a specialist like we were mentioning, but two, you also have to be a lot more social and collaborative. We used to be able to work in our silos, we'd show up with our headphones on and just work and program away, but now you were involved in a lot more brainstorming sessions. Going to meet clients, you had to probably dress a little bit nicer, you know. There was actually aspects of the job that had changed for managers, for developers, for everyone in the company. So there was a big role change that had to happen within the organization from a formality perspective.
Yeah, from the, again, going from the top down of the management team and knowing that my role was going to change, it made me a little bit nervous, it made me a little bit uneasy, making sure that we were all going to sit in a room and define what these new roles meant, what were the new responsibilities of me. And not only just that open, from my 12-year career as a developer, I knew what a developer should do, I knew what a tech lead should do, I knew what all these things that the industry or the old school industry kind of told us what we need to do. So it wasn't even just the role at open, it was a little bit of just my career path in general. And not just for me, but for my colleagues. There's other product owners and Scrum Masters back at Open as well. So we all have to sit essentially just pen and paper. What does this new role look like? What are the new expectations? How does it look? And then we had the same kind of exercise with the developers. Are you okay with it? Since we're changing the role and some have been with us for years, we obviously want to make sure that they're still happy. So we went through those same exercises to make sure. And that's where we brought up things like the primary and secondary skill sets and things like that, to make sure that in this transformation of roles, we still made sure that everyone was happy, everyone's still out of place, everyone was still doing something that they were passionate about and liked.
Trust. Such a huge one that's often overlooked. So Steve mentioned the sprint retrospective. Now imagine sitting down with your entire team and having to talk openly about the mistakes that you made, or the things that you could have done better, or you know, areas that you're weak and you recognize that you're weak and you're looking for advice on how to improve. Not every work environment offers that. You know, before open, I definitely didn't have that in my career. I was a consultant. If I sat down with my managers, my clients, I was like, I feel like I'm weak in this area. They'd be like, why would we be your competitor? Right? So we would then see you later. So this environment of trust was super important to us because we knew that the retro was one of those key aspects where we could continuously improve as an organization, where the team had to be able to talk openly. We had that circle of trust. What's that movie? The circle of trust with you can't break the circle of trust. And you know what? We made a mistake one day. We broke the circle of trust. We have a few development teams that opened. One of them, they had a really bad sprint. The bad sprint happens. And they were in the middle of retro, and the bad sprint meant that we didn't deliver what we said we were going to deliver, but it did take us the amount of time, and we spent the client's money. And the project manager came into that sprint retro, and instead of saying, what could we have done better and where can we improve, that PM laid out the law. You guys screwed up. This is a huge mistake. The client is so upset. What are you going to do? And just bam, bam, bam. And then that circle of trust was shattered. It was broken. So what do we do? The PM wasn't good enough. And that's something you can do, right? Your Scrum Master, your Project Manager, they might not be invited to your retro. And it did take some time, and it did rebuild that trust, and the PM is now part of that circle again. However, the retro and that trust, you need to protect, right? You really, really need to protect it, because without it, people are not going to collaborate, they're not going to share feedback, you're never going to get the full value of the retrospective without it.
Yeah.
Are there any other tricks for trust that you've been...
It just comes down to positive reinforcement, I think, and constructive criticism, how we talk to each other. In that particular case that Chris is talking about, we know that we took longer, we're grown adults, we're transparent. We don't need to get scolded, per se, but rather, what can we do to get better? We all went into that room, you're in a retro, we can all be transparent and say, yes, I did this, that I probably could have done it a little bit better, and it took twice as long. It's okay for everyone else to share that. The end goal of that, just with that positive reinforcement, is, well, just how do we get better the next time? And how do we get better the next time after that? And so on and so on.
The backlog. How many of you are... Yeah,
fair. It's just a question versus meet the parents. How much do you guys spend for this transformation? How much do you spend in training?
Financially? The first initial certifications were 20,000 to have management team certified. And then after that, I don't think we even tracked the overall cost of all the internal professional development and things, but it's quite similar.
But for outside, what do you want to do to get your Scrum Master?
So those certs were 20,000 for the 15 people or something like that. Okay, the backlog. So, how many of you are privileged enough to work on one project at a time? One privileged individual in this room. That is beautiful. And everyone else is bigger and loud. So, if you work in the agency world, you've probably become very accustomed to working on 2, 5, maybe 12 projects. Probably 12. Simultaneous projects. Because, you know, one client, they went on holiday, and you have to do some work, right? Because you're billable and your time matters. So all of a sudden, you end up with multiple projects on your plate. And yet, Agile Scrum say that you're meant to have this one backlog. It's your to-do list. It's everything that the team needs to do top to bottom. And then you're starting to ask the question, well, how am I going to take 12 to-do lists and bring them all together into one? And this was actually, I'd say we probably spent 5 to 10 hours in meetings just trying to hash out what that process looked like. Because we knew we had to get to a single backlog for a team, but we had no idea how to take 10 different requirement lists, mesh them together, and still treat our clients fairly and maintain their timelines and so on.
Yeah, we'll get to the kind of what we did for it. There's a few slides coming with software and stuff like that. So,
for
the time.
It's very good. Stories. So, carrying on from the backlog. So, the backlog is your list of requirements. When we started talking to our clients in the sense of vision and objectives, all of a sudden our old way of collecting requirements just wasn't the same anymore. When they're telling us they want to multiply revenue or they want to increase market awareness within a particular sector or audience group, all of a sudden how does that translate into how many content types you need? Well, it really doesn't, right? How many taxonomies you need doesn't make any sense at all. So we had to come up with a new way of defining our requirements when working with our clients. So we borrow this concept called stories, which has actually become more and more popular with Agile.
Yeah, do you guys are aware of what stories are from an Agile perspective? So instead of just saying the requirement is to build a event listing page, the idea of it, and it goes back to that business value that we were talking about before, the idea of the story is, as a person, I need to go to a website to search for an event in a timely manner so I know what I'm doing on Saturday evening. So that one story, when we put it in real words, that everyone can kind of understand, it doesn't matter if it's Drupal or any other technologies, we put it that way, the client instantly knows, like, yes, that's exactly what I want. You hear me loud and clear, we are on the same page. As the product owner, we kind of bring that back to the team. We say that to the team, easily the team can be on the same page. What ends up happening at that point is we bring it internally and we break up that story into actual tasks that we can achieve in Drupal or in any technology. So that one story, which is more of a business value story and not necessarily tied to technology or a single task, then gets broken down into kind of the tech talk or what we need to do internally. And one story might actually lead to 100 things that we need to do. But those 100 things, as we look backwards, should always lead back up to achieving that goal of whatever that story is.
Absolutely. I'd say when I explain stories, I tell people it's a very broad requirement that, like Steve mentioned, is value-based, so that you can understand what this requirement is, who is going to benefit from it, and then clients will prioritize, which is perfect timing. The next challenge is prioritization. So there is a concept that we haven't hit on it a lot, but in project management, we have the iron triangle of constraints. We've got our resources, so our money, we've got our time, and we've got our scope. You guys have been managing projects for a while, so you're familiar. So in the iron triangle waterfall, your scope is fixed, and the other two constraints are meant to be variable, which means that you have to go to your clients and be like, hey, we're going to deliver exactly what you want, but I don't know exactly how long it's going to take, and it's probably going to cost more or less than what I'm quoting you today. Now, Agile is a flip. They say that with a flexible scope, meaning that you know your requirements are going to change from what we think they are today, we can guarantee you on-time, on-budget delivery. Everyone's mind explodes, right? Like, what do you mean you're going to deliver a digital project on time and on budget? But Agile allows you to do that. But the biggest trick to it is prioritization of the backlog. You have your list of requirements, and you need to work actively with your client to manage the priority of the scope and the flexibility of the scope. So then one day, you show up to work, and Steve, as a product owner, will say, okay, here's our 10 stories. Which one of these is going to bring the maximum business value to your organization today? And then from there, you would order them all based on business value, and then you have your to-do list. And the theory behind it is that if you only get through the first six of the 10 on that list, those six bring the maximum business value, and the other four are so low on the list that the client probably doesn't even care. And now, after a year and a half of doing this, we can confirm that, you know, we can successfully, and keep our clients happy, drop those bottom four. So it's kind of a neat way, but it's really prioritize. One of my favorite games to play is kind of a Monopoly game. You give everyone $1,000 around the boardroom, like Monopoly dollars. Then you go through your stories, and they have to put dollar blockets to it. And then eventually they run out of money, of course, right? And then you count up how much each requirement gathered in funding, and like big Monopoly money, and then you just order it accordingly. So if they're smart, they're going to actually reserve their money, and they're going to put it where they think it goes. And at the end, you get an order backlog. And then as time progresses, maybe priorities change. You go through this exercise not once, but every 2 weeks, at our company at least, and you reprioritize your backlog. Maybe senior management wants to see something completely different. Maybe we're dropping the U.S. subsidiary, they don't matter anymore, so let's put them at the bottom of the list. Whatever might be happening, you reprioritize every 2 weeks, and that's how we manage the scope. And we keep the scope flexible in a way that the client is guaranteed to still get optimal value from the project. Estimates. Everyone has estimate problems, doesn't matter what methodology you're following, right? Estimates are really the development team's best guess, or the developer's best guess, as to how long something is going to take, and on top of that, you know, what's involved in the task, right? Now, you know, if you really are driven on getting accuracy on estimates, you probably track estimates, you track estimate variances, and then you're working with the developers to try to get more and more accurate on those things. But everyone kind of knows that estimates are the bane of all project management you know, problems, or like the source of the problems, because if you misestimate one thing significantly, it can throw off all of your forecasts for the project, and it can actually set off the tone of any communication that happens. So you've got a really good trick for estimates.
Yeah, so has anyone heard of planning poker before? Couple people. So planning poker is essentially a game that we play. We make it fun when we meet as a team. And we take that story, and like I said, we take that overarching value story and break it up into tasks. So we sit as a team, and since everyone is more of a generalist now, everyone gets to put on their architecture hat and say, okay, well, it means we might need a content type and a view and a block and this and that. Then essentially we start estimating. What we do is play planning poker at that point, which is essentially a deck of cards with some numbers on it. Everyone gets a deck, and everyone votes on the estimate for that in each individual task. We go as granular as possible, and we say, okay, from this story, it's task one. How long is task one going to take us? And everyone flips over their card. In most cases, I was going to say everyone is different. Not everybody is different, but in most cases, there's some different numbers from a two-day to a one-day to a one-hour to a one-week. At that point, what we do is take the person that has the highest number and the person that has the lowest number, and they need to explain themselves. Why is it going to take a week versus why is it going to take an hour? Then once they essentially explain ourselves, we turn our cards over and we vote again. And we vote again, usually it gets a little bit more narrow. And then we still say, highest and lowest, you have to explain yourself. Why is it going to take this? Why is it going to take that? And that's where usually the conversation ends up being, oh, for this project 2 months ago, I actually did something very similar and it was like this, so I know if I did it again, it'd probably be less time. The other person might say, like, I've just never done it before, so I'm just guessing because it's an estimate. We still try to narrow those. We vote again until we get to it as close as possible. Sometimes we get to a number that everyone can live with, one single number that everyone flips over, and it's the same. In some cases, when we flip it over and it's always going to be different, we obviously don't keep on playing that game. We usually go with the higher number just to make sure that we're accounting for risk or accounting for things that come up. Or the Scrum Master or myself as the product owner will kind of jump in and say, okay, well, we've heard all sides and we think that based on everything in that final vote, we'll put this as the number in our software. That's what we'll report back to the client.
And the last challenge that we had with software, there's actually two women here from Rally. They got bought out by CA. They have a software similar in Jira. It's interesting to talk about. But software was a big challenge for us. Before we made this transformation, Basecamp, email, those were our primary go-tos for managing to-do lists and tasks. Now Basecamp, everyone kind of loves Basecamp for the simplicity, the intuitive interface, and so on. But the minute that we had to manage this backlog, the prioritization, the cross-functional teams, the assignment of tasks, the logging of work, and so on, it all just completely fell apart on us. And we knew that we had to take a big step further in maturing our software. So Steve, tell them about that work.
Yeah, so it was extremely painful, to be completely honest. So we scoured the web, myself and some colleagues, and I want to say we probably tried every piece of software out there, or ones that at least came up in a Google search or things that we heard about, and essentially just tried them out, signed up for the 15-day free trials, knowing that we needed this single backlog, knowing that we had multiple teams, knowing that we had multiple projects, so on and so on, and we just tried the software to see how, okay, if I come in tomorrow and I have to use this software, does it work for us or not? In most cases, they all failed. Some were amazing at one thing, but really didn't have something else. Some maybe were a middle ground. So at the end of the day, we actually settled on Jira. So we settled on Jira because it had the most of what we needed. Still not perfect. It has APIs, so essentially we can program it to do whatever we want. It has plugins, although it can get pretty pricey. At least there's other people out there similar to Drupal that at least are contributing something back, even if you have to pay for it. And then we were able to manipulate it just enough that it did fit into our day-to-day of how we wanted to work, which is what we really wanted to focus on. We didn't want to pick Jira because the industry told us that Jira is the most popular one and we should just use it for the sake of using it. We truly chose the piece of software that fit into what we needed to accomplish with all these meetings and all this transformation, and it just so happened to be Jira.
With that said,
we
still have 1 million Jira edits, so
yes,
I don't
absolutely
for any sense think that is an easy thing. One of the biggest mistakes we made as an agency, I think, is we're very smart in terms of investing like a Scrum Master and a Product Owner certification. We didn't invest in Lavigne and Atlassian for their video training. We didn't think video training was a cool way to build our training, I guess. And as a result, we had to learn Jira on our own, which was a huge mistake. If I could redo it, we definitely would have bought the videos, things pulling someone in from San Francisco, wherever they are. Because Jira and the Atlassian suite are not intuitive products like Basecamp is. Extremely complex, we've learned the hard way, and we should have done the hard way. So if you guys are going to consider transitioning, the learning resources they have on are not terrible. So, not terrible, that's our condition. And that's software. And that's the last challenge we're talking about today. So today's talk before we get into questions. So today's talk is meant to help you understand if you're thinking of switching between Agile methodology. We talked a lot about the Scrum methodology, but an Agile framework overall. You know, hopefully it sheds some light on the challenges that we face, how it is that we overcame those challenges as well. I do think that, I think we can both agree that this transformation has been extremely successful, not just from like the morale of the team and the company, but also the happiness of our clients at the end of the day. So we're super happy with the results. It was definitely a bit of a mountain to climb, and we're still climbing it. So to give you some insight, now we're bringing designers into the mix. We've always been a really heavily technically based agency, but for the first time we're bringing in creative people and really shaking things up. And creative work doesn't necessarily fit into the Scrum methodology or Agile backlog the same way. So now we're experimenting with further advancements. There's things called like Lean UX, if you've heard of that methodology. The definition of ready, so having our design backlog and development backlog, and then doing scattered iterations and so on. So all that to say that Agile is actually acted as a really great framework for us that now we can tweak and modify to our own kind of needs and our changes and what we're trying to do as an agency to be more competitive. So everything is still evolving. It's never going to be like, okay, we're Agile, I'm not going to consider this again. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind, you're going to have to change as your organization changes, as the market changes, and as the tech changes as well. So, questions and answers, guys? We're happy to answer any questions you have.
So, you have the slide on the ring, talking about onboarding and the first two-three sprints.
Yeah, so we put lesson plans together for all of our, the entire team. Again, from the person that we just hired to people that have been there for years, we all have lesson plans. So we have kind of them already developed in our back pocket on what people should work on how, or when, sorry. We also make sure that everyone has ACMIA certification, so that's a huge help. So we know what at least an end goal is, and we know how we can make these lesson plans to get to there. So that's more from like a formalized training, but then we also just do shadowing, peer programming, things like that. Make sure that you sit with the developer beside you, then the next day don't sit with that person, sit with someone else, a little bit of diversity. But even go sit with your PM for an hour and just see what the PM does. Come sit with me for an hour and come to a client meeting that you normally wouldn't come to just to see what it's all about. That's where we say the formal training, but then also in that 2 to 3 sprints, it is like you still can do some client work, but at the same time, you can still do some shadowing. So some is formalized, some is kind of impromptu.
Do you want to
end it? I've got two questions. One is if you've got, remote people,
yeah.
How do you have these teams if you have people that are remote, or do you have people that are remote?
So right now we actually have, it is interesting. So we do have one developer doing a program called Remote Year. If you live in a different country every month for 12 months. So she's currently doing the whole globe. She really should be at home right now. That's super cool. I'm really jealous. But it was a little bit of an interesting update. So one, everything in our office is video enabled. So we use Zoom communications. Like their Zoom platform for video conferencing is great because it's like you're there. But when it comes to managing remote workers, I have definitely heard the rule of thumb is a remote worker should be in a remote team. If the whole team is remote, it's really hard to forget one person, for example.
Yeah.
But when you have a remote worker, there's one, and a team of 7, it's very easy to forget to start a conference call. So for us, it's about just being on top of being mindful that that person is waiting on the line somewhere else. It's probably 3 a.m. their time when they're trying to connect. So it's more out of respect and mindfulness of the remote worker. And then we try to enable video conferencing on all dialogues, so that way we have that personal connection still. She comes back every quarter, so we do see her every 3 months as well. So there's a lot of like coming to the office, work with us a little bit, and then go back to wherever it is in the world you are. But build that personal connection I think you need. But those are just some of the techniques we use, but I really recommend, like, we've been thinking about remote teams quite a bit. I think that if we were really advanced, all of our remote workers would be in one team together, and that way Yeah.
Yeah, the other question was, so if you have these larger teams and everybody's kind of working together like that, how do you keep your budgets?
In which sense? CEO budget or client budget?
The project. The project. If you have more heads, you have more overhead.
Yeah, for sure. So our teams aren't that large. We count them as seven. So a seven-person team has a product owner, project manager, and five developers. Soon to be five, four developers and a designer. So the pods are really small in our company. So it's not, we don't tend to burn client budgets over like very quickly, especially if you have two or three projects going on at the same time. And then the project manager's role on the project is to maintain the budget. So we have budget forecasts, but since day one, we can actually forecast, well, how many sprints is a client going to get, add so many days of development for iteration, things like that. So we can actually divide the budgets over after.
But if you have four of your people going to the client meeting?
Oh, you mean like client meetings to take care of? Yeah, so we do in our quotes have to say that there's an additional overhead for what we call ceremonies meetings for Scrum. We just have to articulate in the sales process. This is the value it's going to bring. It's a lot better to have five people around the table coming up with the best business solution than it would be if you had 20. So clients just dictate. Barbara?
Yeah, so how do you organize the sprints? Do you have multiple pods in your one sprint? And how much do you run in parallel?
Yeah, so essentially, since we have one backlog, that one backlog consists of all of our project items. And then when we do sprint planning, we pull from that one single backlog. And then we run essentially one sprint per team. So our pods, what we call them, our development teams are essentially just our agile teams. So if we have three agile teams, then we have three sprints running at the same time, each team responsible for their own. And within those sprints, it can be from 1 to 10 projects, depending on what that agile team is covering or what clients they have or what projects are on the go.
And what are the components of our work?
So we still try to accommodate them in the process, so we still put support work into our backlog. But we know that support work can't necessarily wait for 2 weeks. So in our sprints, we essentially just, I don't like to use the word buffer, but for lack of a better term, we buffer them or have a little space for that support work. So we know that we're starting support work, we go along, something for support might come up or it might blow up, or we have security updates or core updates happen, we need to stop what we're doing and help our clients do things like that. We essentially just adjust for them. And that's where, like myself as a product owner that's prioritizing things, we work very hand in hand with the project managers to make sure, like, what are the budgets, what are the allocations, what room do we think we need, or people can we adjust for the assumption of someone being sick this sprint or someone going on vacation this sprint. Those are all things we take into account.
I also say that we're partnered with Active, so their global support channel. They do have SLAs, so for clients that require, like, I need an immediate response, it doesn't fit within our 4 working hours. We always have Active right there that will jump in. Say, okay, well, let me resolve the server issue, whatever's happening. So having a partner, like if your organization can't support the enterprise level, having an enterprise support partner for us slows it down. So guys, one last minute notes of the GOAT conference is coming up. Gatineau, Ottawa, Agile Tour.
Yep.
Yeah, so it's coming up in October.
November.
So if you're a project manager, product owner, recommend definitely checking it out. Phenomenal talks, we'll be speaking there as well. It's where we learned a lot, and our coach and a lot of the Agile coaches in the city get together there. So check that out. We've all been about this talk being here next, so stick around for that.
Improvement.
Hey.
And thank you for coming to the talk. Really great to be on here. So I'll see you later. Cool.